Summertime is known for its barbecues, for hanging out by the pool, and for its yard sales. Each year, thousands of Americans take out their folding tables, throw them out in their front yard, and take all of their junk and put it on it with one goal in mind, making hundreds in cash. Today, luckily, Dr. Lori from Auction Kings, who's an expert appraiser there, is here to talk to us about what it's like being on the show, how she got involved, and what she's been up to lately. Let's take a look at this clip of Dr. Lori and Cindy Shook on Auction Kings.
Hey, Cindy.
Hey, Dr. Lori, how are you?
Good, how are you doing, honey?
I have something really strange I need to show you.
I'm good at strange, let's see.
Dr. Lori is an appraiser we use when we've got obscure items like the Vitapulsar, so we asked her to stop by.
There you go.
Right? Buddy. Have you seen this before? Look at your face. You're like, oh gosh, Dr. Lori, this thing. You got an SOS electric pulsar, also known as a Vitapulsar.
It's a pulsar, all right.
Yeah, it's
a pulsar. I have to tell you that.
The women in the 1920s used these devices.
What did they need them for?
Well, you know, sometimes you need a little help in the bedroom.
Really?
Yeah, the flappers.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Basically, what they said was, we can use this for anything that ails you. And you actually would take the probes, and you would kind of give yourself a little jolt and everything would kind of get pumping.
Little jolt? Well, I ran it right up my neck.
Did you use a battery? What kind?
D batteries. I've
D
got
battery.
Some right here. You want to try it on yourself?
No, I am not trying it on myself.
Not?
I know better.
Well, I certainly didn't.
All right, our guest today can be seen on Auction Kings every Thursday night at 9 p.m. Dr. Lori, thank you so much for joining me today.
Happy to be with you.
We're so happy to have
thank
you here.
Thank you.
So, Dr. Lori, you are all over TV.
Yes, all over, everywhere.
You're everywhere.
Flip the channel, it's me. It's like Bugs Bunny, first base, second base, third base. I'm every place, I'm kidding.
You're going across the country right now to do a whole bunch of different radio and television interviews.
That's right, we've been doing a lot of press for Auction Kings. And I've been doing that, I'm new to season 3. And the show is just a lot of fun.
It seems like a lot of fun. Now, actually, I spoke with Cindy Shook. She was on my show not too long ago.
Doesn't she just make you smile?
I
don't you just go, oh, it's
I
you,
I love
Cindy.
She's fantastic. I think I called her the sweetest Georgia peach you're ever going to meet or
she
something.
She is. She's a fan favorite.
She's great. And you and her, you guys really bond a lot on the show, it seems.
Yeah, we have a good rapport. She's really wonderful. She's really funny because she's sort of like your mom and then, you know, the girl who you go to the bar with. You know, she's both. I mean, she really is. She's a lot of fun. And then she's also like, okay, we're going to get this done. We're going to do this right. Da, da, da. And, you know, she knows a lot about what's going on. So when you really need the inside track, that's where you go.
Right, Cindy?
Yeah, Cindy's the one.
Now I know she's in charge of tagging everything as well, so she's got to know what's going on.
Yeah, she's running. I mean, you know, to take nothing away from Paul Brown, who has a keen sense of how auctions work, and you have to market all different things to different audiences all the time. So, I mean, you know, and he's excitable and wonderful and, you know, very, very good looking. But Cindy is sort of, I always say, sort of the lifeblood. You know, if you know, Paul's the brain, she's the lifeblood, the circulatory system going through in that auction house.
But so she helps bring it together.
Yeah, it's a wonderful cast, as you probably know. And, you know, and I think that a lot of people are, everyone knows Cindy because she's sort of out front with, and she and I have a great rapport. And we had a great rapport sort of right out of the chute, which is sort of the way you and I started talking right out of the chute. And that was really very fun. I feel similarly close to Delfino and John, and those guys have a joviality that a lot of people don't see. It's kind of quiet behind the scenes, and they're doing jokes and making jabs, and they're a lot of fun too, but Cindy's great.
Now what is behind the scenes like when you go down there?
Oh, chaos. Yeah, it's just good. You know, it's lights and cameras and the production crew and audio and Dr. Lori, will you shut up a minute so we can get a word in? You know, that kind of thing. But yeah, it's a lot of fun and it's a fabulous environment. An environment I'm very comfortable in, mm-hmm. But a fabulous environment. And I think the show has been wildly popular because people like the people and they're not actors. You have a lot of these reality shows that are actors, mm-hmm. and people go, oh, well, you know, I didn't realize that. So in terms of Auction Kings, these people are really doing this. And, you know, they're just putting on film and telling the story well.
And you two are similar in that way that you...
I'm not an actor.
You're not what I was going to say. I was going to say your job is to appraise items, but you have a camera that follows you around quite often.
Yes, I do. I do about 150 public appraisal events all over the country, mm-hmm. and I've been on television for many years, since the late 1990s. But basically, I've been in front of the camera a long time.
And you're very comfortable in front of the camera. Your personality, for those of you who are watching at home right now, her personality is 10 times bigger than what you see on TV. We've been having
or
so much fun.
Or even bigger than my hips. So, you know, yeah, no, we have been having fun. Yeah.
It's really cool to have a job that you get to share with the public and the public gets to know you, I think.
It's a very fun job. Cool. You know, people say, oh, it's a blessing. It was a lot of hard work, mm-hmm. You know, and people forget that part. And people go, oh, I don't want to hear about the hard work. I want to hear it was magic. It wasn't magic. I went to school forever, you know, and I worked in museums for a long time and I loved objects. And I gave the advice I used to be a university professor, and I gave the advice to myself that I used to give to my college kids, which was, if you love something, go after it and do it. And don't waste time doing something else because somebody else or society or your parents or tell you to. And one day I woke up and said, yeah, why don't you just do that? Instead of telling everybody that this is a good idea for a kid to sort of follow a path, follow that path. And I always liked shiny, sparkly, beautiful things. And I can't say that I came from a family of particular wealth or prestige. My father was a World War II veteran. My mother raised us. I always loved sports, so sports became sort of the first things that I identified and started to evaluate. And then I became a specialist in American art history and antiques and worked at the Yale Art Gallery. And then someone, actually was a CBS television anchor who said to me, you know what, you really could get the point across. We'd like to listen to you talk about stuff. And people were doing yard sales. And people were doing, you know, flea markets, and the economy is kind of changing. And people were saying, I need to make an extra buck. This woman knows a lot about value and quality. Maybe we should listen to what she has to say about what we should keep from grandma's house. So television came later. My joking around got me on shows like The Tonight Show and got me picked up in The Daily Show and other places. So yeah, TV's been very good to me. I always credit sort of, you know, my hairstylist for the good hair dye, so I don't look as old as I really am. But watching Kings has been tremendously a blessing and discovery, and Discovery's a lot of great shows. You know, like Shark Week's this week, you know.
I love Shark Week. Shark Week's the absolute, who in the audience loves Shark Week?
Yeah. And you know, so I really enjoy that, but sports was where I started. I was a university swimmer at Michigan, and just loves sports, any sport all the time. My dad was a major league pitcher for the New York Yankees and the Philadelphia Phillies. After World War II, I say the war, and then I remember that I'm, you know, 16 years too late. There are all these other wars and whatnot. But basically, Auction Kings found me at sea. So I think saw my clips in the Discovery Channel. I was doing a appraisal show on a cruise ship, and I was very seasick, and I got an email. And if any of you have ever tried to get your email on a cruise ship, it's just not happening very easily. It's very difficult. And they got in touch with me and said, we really want to interview you by Skype. And I'm like, I'm in the middle of the Atlantic. You can't interview me by Skype. I can't get a quick enough, you know, a line. So basically, after some seasickness and some connections, and I did the Skype interview with Los Angeles, and I ended up in Atlanta and on the Auction King set with Cindy.
So, that's always fun. That's a good time.
It's fun.
Now, how often are you going down there? Because I know you are this season. You've been in there quite a bit.
Yes. So I want to say that we tape, and for those of you who know the lingo, we put it in the can. You know, so we tape it, we put it in the can, and we tape everywhere between once every month, once every 6 weeks. Of course, I come in for different types of objects. I can appraise anything, but you know, they select objects that work best for each of the experts. There are only a few of us, and yes, I get a little bit more time than maybe some of the others, but that just has to do with objects and specialties and telling the story well, which is up to the production company, which is Authentic Entertainment. They do a really good job. We have a tremendous crew. And I've had tremendous crews before. They're really good. So.
If I was doing an appraising job, I'd find so many items that I'd like that I'd just end up buying them all.
Well,
I would have a big collection. Do you have a collection of anything?
I do have objects that I like, yes. Mm-hmm. And I am interested in sports. So I have my sports collectibles. You know, I have my signed baseballs. But I also have pieces in the art world. And I've written several books about American art. So I do have some American art. But for the most part, for example, Cindy is a tremendous collector of two things that I think everybody in this arena will like: shot glasses and Coca-Cola.
So, now I know the Coca-Cola from the show.
So yeah, so she collects those, and Elijah, who is Paul Brown's son, who's a wonderful person and a lot of fun on the set, he's usually wearing some kind of vintage guitar or rock and roll t-shirt. So I don't know if he has a collection of them, but he's got a lot of them, at least what I've seen. So I think everybody collects something, and you know, objects come with emotions. They carry emotions. So there are things that you say, oh, I can't part with that. You know, I'll date myself. I have a Kermit the Frog doll from when Kermit the Frog was young. You know, not now when he has new friends like Elmo and stuff, but way back then. So, and that's something that isn't worth that much, maybe $100 or something, but valuable to me because it reminds me of being a little kid. So, you know.
And that's something that I see. There's so many shows, you know, people are obsessed right now with the shows that show items, and people try and sell them, and they find out that maybe their little tea kettle that they had forever is worth a couple $1,000s.
Yeah.
But one of the things that I see that occurs so often is people price something so highly because of their emotional attachment. Right. Do you find that a lot when you're talking with people?
I find that America believes they don't have anything valuable. And I talk to America. I've been America's appraiser a long time. Mm-hmm. And they think I couldn't possibly have anything valuable, but I'll come and watch everybody else have something valuable. So there are a lot of valuable things out there that you might miss, the general person might miss. And then what I tend to see is on TV, you see everything's worth $1 million. And it depends on the condition, the value, the quality, the arena, who's buying it, where are you trying to sell it. You know, a Civil War sword is going to sell better in Atlanta than it is in Boston. You find me a Paul Revere teapot, a silver teapot, you're going to sell that better in Boston than you are in Atlanta. You've got to know what you're doing. You know, a football from the Super Bowl is going to sell better in February than it will in October. So you've got to think about these things. You know, Lawrence Taylor's football Super Bowl ring just went for, I don't know, $200,000, $300,000. I think it was $250,000 recently. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's a lot of money, right?
Yeah.
Don't sell it in August, in July and August. Sell it at Super Bowl time. So you want to go, no one told you this? You know, yeah. And I'm sitting there on my Facebook going, what is he doing? You know? So there are those kinds of tricks. They're not even tricks. There's guidelines that you want to think about. When I worked at the Yale Art Gallery, for example, they would say, you know, we want you to fill a hole in the American art collection. Well, even if it's a good bargain, I can't come back with a Rembrandt who's not American. I've got to get an American piece. So people will say that my sort of contribution to Auction Kings is being able to show you sort of the broader scope of what the art and the antique world is really like on the scale that is very, very well established private collectors, museums, and other people who really pay big bucks for this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You're gonna see different things. You see on Auction Kings where the Vitapulsar, for example, was a very popular segment that Cindy and I did together. And it was a quack medical device that sort of would cure whatever ails you. Sort of gives you a little jolt. And interestingly enough, I said, based on other sales records, that it would sell for about $75.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody in the auction bay that day paid $150 for it. I thought she was crazy. I was like, $100? You're paying double for that thing? Which, it's not the value.
Uh-huh.
So just speaking strictly as a valuator, you know, just speaking strictly as value, you start to go, wow, that's double. He did, you know, Paul Brown knew what he was doing. He did very well for the seller and for himself. So, and for his auction house. So that's an unusual kind of thing for it to go double. But I've seen, you know, those bidding wars start, and it's exciting, and people go, people don't even want to go, oh yeah, I want to get involved, you know, like I'll bid, you know, so it does happen.
Now, there's so many people who inherit different items from grandma, from grandpa, whatever it is, and they don't know what the value is, and maybe they might be throwing something that's a couple $1,000s away.
Yes.
I know my grandma, who's actually in the audience with us today, she has several items at home that I don't know the value of. I don't know that she really knows the value of. All she knows is it's expensive.
Okay.
That's it.
Okay.
When somebody who knows that they have items that are expensive, what do they do? What can you do for them?
What do you want to do?
Let's
see, I always make somebody articulate a goal.
Okay.
You know, as an appraiser, you have to know sort of what path you're trying to take. So if you say, I want the money, I want the cash right now,
mm-hmm.
okay, then we want to open it up to the global market. How do you do that? You're doing that right here. You know, you open it up to as many people as you can get. So for your, I don't know, Kermit the Frog doll, you may not only want to have it in northeastern Pennsylvania, central Pennsylvania, to be the only market. So if you only market it locally, you may not get as much money for it. But if you put it on the internet and you market it, and market it, I don't mean just post it on one website and then hope. I mean do some work.
Yeah.
You might get Hans and Hamburg, who has to have your Kermit the Frog doll. You know, Mario and Milan is, you know, a Miss Piggy freak and has to have it. That kind of thing. So you want to make sure that that's what you're doing. And the examples might sound silly, but this is what will stick in your head. You'll go, okay, this makes sense because it's simple. But it requires work.
Yeah. Now, I actually have something today that I brought from my grandma's house.
Okay.
And
so you're already scoping around grandma's house.
We're already, yeah. I'm looking around to see what can we get out of this?
What can I get out of it? So why did you choose this?
This was my uncle's.
Okay, uncle.
And she had this hanging in my uncle's room.
Does he know you've got it?
He doesn't know that yet, so I'm just not going to give him the link to this video, that's all.
I had permission from him.
You have permission.
He
we have permission.
Didn't want it, okay. So I gave it to Justin.
Okay, it's yours, Justin.
I don't know much about it.
Okay.
I don't know anything.
Well, the Rangers win 5-4 from the Wings. Islanders Hawks play 4-4 tie. And it's 1974, is that what I'm looking at?
Yeah.
Okay. 1974.
Okay, it's 1974, and it's hand-painted.
Correct.
What do we know about the artist?
Absolutely nothing.
Okay, is it a good artist? Just look at it. Does it look like somebody who knows what they're doing or has some artistic training?
I mean, I would have drawn stick figures, so he's better than I am.
Me too, right. You know, people go, oh, Dr. Lurie, draw me something. A stick figure is about what I can do. So basically what you're looking at here is you want to see, does it look like and fool you into believing that these are three-dimensional figures on a flat two-dimensional surface? And I'd say yeah. So some training for the artist. So now we're looking at, oh, okay, so this person's kind of knows what they're doing. It's on a obviously authentic New York Times newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that old, okay? 1974, you're thinking that's old. I'm thinking that's not, right? Like, you know, my mother's 90, she thinks I'm young. My 16-year-old niece doesn't think I'm young. So, you know, it's that kind of thing. So basically, in terms of value, I'm gonna look at quality for the execution because now it's become not just a newspaper, but it's become sort of a picture of what happened. Right?
Mm-hmm.
On the newspaper. The newspaper was chosen as a backdrop purposefully, right?
Correct.
So value on this is probably somewhere in the $125 to $150 range retail.
Okay.
If you saw it in a shop, that's probably what you would be required to pay.
Okay.
For this. Where do you sell it? Where do you sell it?
Maybe to the New York Times. That would be a, I think
somewhere
that would be a good place to start.
Somewhere in New York, someone who's going to have, you know, more of an interest in, of course, this particular team,
mm-hmm.
you know. And then with a little bit more research, we'd find out more about the artist and see where their sales records are and go from there. But conservatively, you're probably in that range.
Okay, so...
And I do that 20,000 objects a year.
I was just gonna say, you do this all the time, and if somebody wants to hire you to appraise an item like that, let's say they've got a closet full of grandma's stuff.
You could do that.
They want to know what it is. Where can they get that information? How can they hire you?
Well, the best thing to do is watch Auction Kings. And the reason why I say that, watch Auction Kings on Discovery, because we're gonna give you tips without hiring me. You're gonna give you tips. You're gonna start to learn about how it all works. You're going to see what the good, the bad, the ugly is. And you need to see all different elements. In terms of me, you can get to me through the facebook.com/auctionkings website or discovery.com for Auction Kings. My website is drlorieb.com. But for the most part, I think most people start to understand and enjoy more about appraisals and appraisers and how I'm different than most appraisers. Most appraisers don't have my education. Most appraisers don't have my experience. Most appraisers also, you know, I want to have this rapport with people because I want the people to get it.
Mm-hmm.
Because mom probably has something valuable. Dad probably has something. Grandma definitely has something valuable in the house. Not only you, but basically what you're looking at is you're looking at these types of things that are sentimental, but also can have value to someone else. They fall into certain categories. We talk a lot about certain categories on Auction Kings. The objects that are most valuable typically fall into that oddities category.
Mm-hmm.
It's oddball, we don't know, and those tend to do well. Things that everybody loves, you know, you see a 1955 Thunderbird come on, and you're like, wow, I love that car. If you don't drive, you love that car. You don't care. It's just beautiful and sort of the allure of the American car. You know, the great Ford cars that come in oftentimes on the show. Choppers are very popular. We see a lot of that. Original fine art, furniture, sports collectibles, naval or nautical pieces
have been very, very collectible. And like for me, I'm going to be talking about movie memorabilia in the coming weeks. Mm-hmm. So the show's going to talk a little bit about some of our very, very famous celebrities. I'm going to be talking with Paul Brown on a segment about Elizabeth Taylor and one of her very valuable pieces of movie memorabilia. So, you know, I think I get the best objects to appraise on Auction Geeks, but for the most part, we really have a lot of fun in trying to show people what you're looking for mm-hmm. and what you can expect, what's realistic. You know, not, oh, I expect I'm gonna make $1 million on my, you know, I don't know, on my earrings, when really it's like, well, your earrings like yours have never sold for more than $2,000, so you're not gonna make $1 million, you know.
So there's items that you don't wanna count on saving for retirement. There's items that not necessarily you would be like, this is worth a lot, I'm gonna retire with this item. You could be disappointed sometimes.
That's true. That's absolutely true. I do say, you know, if mom or grandma told you that something's valuable, they're probably right. You know, just listen to your mother. She's probably right. But, you know, close enough kind of thing. And those things that are important to you, financial or monetary value, sure, that's important. But if you're a big Rangers fan, this is a big deal to you, hey, hold on to it. It's not taking up that much room. Mm-hmm. And as time goes on, it will increase in value, just if you keep it in good shape.
So if it's in good shape, maybe 30 years from now, that 125, 150, potentially 500,
you 600, got it.
You never know.
You got it. It's usually, you know, I've seen pieces like that increase in value usually anywhere between 3% and 5% over a year. And that's not a bad return today.
No, I'll take any percent, that's all right.
Yeah, and collection value. If you collect a particular type of thing, anytime you add to that same category of collectibles, it increases in value. You know, that kind of thing. You know, everyone's saying, oh, Dr. Lurie's gloves are really valuable. A lot of people want my gloves, you know? And I'm like, well, you know, because I always wear them and a lot of appraisers don't, and uh-huh. they should. So people are like, oh, you know, so funny things like that become valuable. So, you know, at my office, they're like, wear the gloves, you know? Like, then they won't have to come to work anymore.
You should start like a glove line or something.
Yeah,
start selling Dr. Lurie gloves.
I should do that. We'll do that together, Justin.
All right, there we go, look at this. We're making history right now,
sure,
right here.
Right.
All right, so.
It's your idea, you gotta get credit.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Lurie, for joining us today. We're so happy to have you here as our guest.
And, thank you.
Thank you for appraising my grandma's picture frame for us.
Anytime.
You can catch Dr. Lurie on Auction Kings every Thursday night from 9 until 10 p.m. Or you can also check her out on Facebook as well. I saw you've got a lot of different events, so she might be coming to your area and a lot of free appraisal shows, correct?
That's right. So, all over the country and even on the high seas, you'll see me and Auction Kings on Discovery, so I hope you watch.
All right, well, thank you so much, Dr. Lurie.